And let's recall some key points that we emphasize in our work. Assemblage can be said that is a term employed to denote such a heterogeneous mixture of parts and their multiple connections at different scales in a state of symbiosis and synthesis while retaining their principal identities to compromise a form in constant transformation. Such forms are to be differentiated from structures, as in philosophy elements participating in a structure lose their autonomy and function as part of a whole, while in assembled subsystems retain their autonomy and independent functionality. Assemblage thinking is characterized by its high level of abstraction. Elements can be practically anything, and the same applies for relations. Difference is considered as a creative force, and the significant point, it's not subject, objects, and or concepts as such, but rather their connections, interactions, and flows. Transformations of an assemblage are undertaken by the so-called abstract machine, an elusive concept, under the action of which an assemblage evolves to new forms. The abstract machine brings virtualities into actualities. It's a functorial morphogenetic mapping from the space of possibilities, virtualities, to the space of actualities. Connectivity plays a crucial part in the functioning of the abstract machine, blending the local with the global, and since connectivity doesn't necessarily imply the notion of the distance, assemblages are deeply topological concepts. Another important dimension of any assemblage on any scale is territorialization, which means the continuous processes along which the assemblage is to be stabilized or established or destabilized and paired, the territorialization. One of the forces that destabilize the identity of an assemblage in the lines of light. The lines of light means change and transformation. About the type, what we mean about imaging is arises from the need to describe and depict the connectivity structure of the assemblage and help to turn it to a concrete conceptual and planning tool. Imagining create and explore a possibility space for potential virtual forms of an assemblage and construct imaginary abstract machine to simulate possible actualizations and help infer information concerning the actual abstract machine that drives evolution as an ongoing process.
So now I have to say something. I'm going to say something that I'm always there for saying. What should we connect? So I'm just going to turn these concepts into basically pictures, and well, not mathematics, but pictures. So as Elektra mentioned, there's a deep topological feeling about this theory of assemblages, connectivity without any distance and all that. So we have to start with topology versus topography. And of course, what gave rise to the field of mathematics and topology was to make this band, where they first discovered, let's say, a surface without having a particular direction, it's not very clear. However, that can be shown in a very, let's say, abstract manner, maybe with a perfect picture. And you can just look at the way that certain points on this, or certain curves on this particular surface are connected. So the blueprint for the Möbius band is what you see on the right-hand side of this graph, which is just the arrows, the points that are being connected, the points that are being identified and how they're connected. Now, of course, I don't have to talk about topology without the proverbial coffee cup. Do I need that? Or
yes.
So you cannot have talk about topology and connectivity without the proverbial coffee cup that turns into the donut. And then at the end of the graph of the slide, we have the connectivity structure. So you have just stripped down it from the bare essential, and the equivalence is the fact that you have a continuous transformation, and this continuous transformation can, you know, sort of deform the surface. You're not allowed to cut, but you can twist, and you can do whatever you want. And at the end of the day, you're just left with, you know, this line over here, this closed curve over here, and this closed curve over here. And that's essentially the same that you have on the donut. You have this one and this one. Okay. So this is sort of the tools that we're going to use for images. So let's start with the concept of the simplex and the superficial complex. You consider entities. At this level of abstraction, we can think of entities as whatever, really. So you have a number of entities, discrete entities, let's call them EI, and then you can have possible connections. So you have unconnected entities that are called zero simplices, and these are denoted like that. You have pairwise connections of the type that Moses showed before on graph, which are called one simplices. So entity I is connected with directly with entity J, so you have this one simplex. Then you have direct interaction of two entities that are called two simplices, you know, like that. And you can continue like this and until you get to n minus one simplices. And then you can have a collection of simplices such that it always contains the face of the simplices it belongs to, and you can call that a simplicial complex. And in fact, this is the way that I think about an assemblage. In my language, I mean, in the way that I was trained, the technical tool to describe an assemblage is simplicial complex. Now, there's a very nice example of that, I think, first proposed by Katz in Gestalt psychology. So you try to define what vanilla ice cream is all about. And you have certain notions. I mean, you have ice, something that's cold, you have vanilla aroma, you have yellow, the color yellow, and all that. But you need to have a direct interaction of vanilla aroma, cold, sweet, and let's say yellow, color yellow, to get to vanilla ice cream. So it's a purely non-linear thing. You cannot add simplices together and get a higher dimensional simplex. You need a fully non-linear interaction. So there's a way to visualize simplices. So this is how you can visualize a direct interaction of three entities. So you have this triangle here, and then you flip the triangle up, so you have something which is purely two-dimensional. And then if you only have interactions between two pairwise interactions, then you take, you know, the inner part, and you're just left with a closed line, what we call a closed one chain. And then this is a one-dimensional object that is embedded in higher dimensions on a two-dimensional space. So our visualization tool is going to be this idea of complexes. Now, if you go to higher dimensions, then you have direct interaction of four entities, E0, E1, E3, and E2. And then you can imagine that as a solid tetrahedron. And then if that the inner part goes, then we are left with direct interactions of three. And of course, there can be an indirect interaction of all four, but only through triple interactions. So it's a different thing. I mean, from the point of view of quality, it's a different thing. So we're going to have the tetrahedron, and then we're going to move the inner part of the tetrahedron, the solid part, and we're left with the same. So how can we go to higher dimensions and get rid of, let's say, the cares of our impediment that we live in three dimensions and we cannot visualize more? So we need some tools that are somehow more technical. Now this is what I mean by a simplicial complex, and here's what we call the geometrical realization. And you have a direct interaction of four entities here, and then this entity is directly interacting with this one, and then you have a direct interaction of three, which is a two simplex. So your simplicial complex is what I think an assemblage can be formalized to. You have this piece of there that might keep its autonomy, then it's somehow connected, and I don't care how, somehow connected with this one, and then you have these entities here that they are connected, keeping their autonomy, but they can interact through this link here. So it's like the graph that Moses showed, but now you go to higher dimensions and you go to higher order interactions. That's another case of the simplistic complex. And now we need to somehow to start and developing material structure. So the way to do that is to use some tools from mathematics, which is called algebraic topology. In fact, Poincaré invented that in the turn of the 20th century. So we need something which is called the Mandel operator. So suppose that you have this one syntax here, then you take the Mandel operator, and the Mandel operator dissolves this link between E0 and E2. So the direct interaction is gone, and then you're left with zero synthesis that are just simply non-interactions. Yeah. Okay. So suppose now that you have these direct interactions by two in pairs, and then at the end of the day they all end up communicating, then you have the boundary operator, and the boundary operator gives you zero because you have a closed circuit. Okay. Now you can go to higher dimensions. You can take this field triangle, so you can take the two singlets, and then the boundary operator removes the inner part, and you're left with a closed chain, a non-dimensional chain. So the direct interaction of three entities somehow dissolved. Suppose you have some sort of a coalition of three players or three agents that dissolves. They're still left by two, and then if you add this boundary operator once more, then you get back to zero. So that gives you an idea of, let's say, ancestry. That's how the boundary operator would act on a solid tetrahedron. And you see that if you have the boundary operator here, then we go from the solid space to a one-dimensional hole. So this existence of the one-dimensional hole somehow gives you the ancestry that a higher structure existed and it no longer exists. So it leaves its trace by this one-dimensional hole. And then here you have the solid, the tetrahedron, and then you have a two-dimensional void. You have what is left if you take the inner part and you're just left with the set. That's, again, another way to trace the ancestry of structures. Okay. Now, going back to this idea of tracing ancestry, you have here a simplistic complex. Okay. Now, this is field, it's quite like C, this is field, but if you take this one chain, this is a closed one-dimensional line, this is another closed one-dimensional line, but these are different. They're different in the sense that this closed line comes from a two-dimensional structure that was somehow disabled by the boundary operator, whereas this one does not come from a higher dimensional structure. So it gives us an idea of ancestry, and this is the technique which is called homology, and allows us to measure the gaps in the structure, allows us to quantify gaps in the structures of various dimensionalities, and there's a series of numbers that are called the Betti numbers that gives us this idea of what gaps are left in the structure. Okay. So we can have some examples. From here you have a structure that has got two one-dimensional holes, so the Betti number 1 is equal to 2, whereas on the right you have a structure that has got one-dimensional structure, so the Betti number is 1. Okay. Now here you've got a simplistic structure, there's no direct link here, so you have two components that are non-interacting, and this is quantified by Betti number 0 being equal to 2. Then you have no one-dimensional hole, so this is quantified by Betti 1 number being equal to 0. And then you have, well, this is a cell, actually, so you have a one two-dimensional void, so this is quantified by Betti number 2 being equal to 1. So even though in higher dimensions you can no longer draw the picture, by having these numbers, by having these Betti numbers, Ellen, I'm a middle-aged man, and I have trouble with all the Betti apparatus.
30 seconds?
No way. That's high. No way. I mean, if you tell us all the technical...
How long?
Well,
not
much.
5 minutes?
Thank you. Most grateful. Okay. So, in higher dimensions, you cannot draw pictures, but you still have these numbers, and these numbers give you a very clear account of structure, and they give you a very clear account of where structures came from, the ancestry of structures. Okay, so now we're able to define this set of virtual states, this set of virtualities, and in our language, this is simply the set of simplicial complexes for any number of vertices. Now, you can keep complexity by the cardinality, as we say, of this set. So if you have, let's say, three vertices, you have six potential states. You see six different ways of connecting with each other. And as you move along, as you move up in the number of vertices, this number becomes huge. So, you know, it's really difficult to navigate this set. Okay. So this is an example of what you can get out of three entities. Okay, you can get zero synthesis, you can get a simplicial complex of a zero synthesis and one simplex, and so on. So this set here contains all possible scenario regarding the connectivity and interaction between these three entities, and contains six in qualitatively different outcomes. Okay. So this is the way we interpret the set of potentialities, virtual diagrams that Deleuze or Belanda talk about. So this is an example, a depiction of what you can have out of eight. This is just three elements out of this set of virtualities for eight entities. And then these are different, let's say, qualitative structures. Here you have the direct interaction of three entities. Now you have the direct interaction of four, sorry, direct interaction of three. Then you have a cell that is left out of something that may evolve the direct interaction of four, and so on. So now we come to defining the abstract machine. Before we do that, there is the concept of scale, which is everywhere inherent in this theory. So we can have a way to discuss that and keep the concept of scale, and this is called persistent homology. Now let's look at the picture. So suppose you have three entities here, and then you look at the scale, which is the length of these disks that I put on the picture. Okay. So now, the rule is that whenever two of these disks, intersect, then you have a link between these two entities. If you have three disks intersecting, then you have a direct link between three entities. So as you move up in scale, then you have something that gives you a structure that consists of unconnected elements. Now, the disks become larger, so you have interaction by two, so you have a simplicial complex with just two, one simplices, and then scale becomes larger and you have a direct interaction. So as you move along scales, you see different patterns forming out of this set of potentialities. So now we come to the imagining of assemblages, and I'll close with that. So the set of all simplicial complexes is the set of all possible virtual states. In our framework, the abstract machine is the dynamical system, let me call it S, that acts on the set of possible virtual states, which is the possibility space, and this action on any virtual state is to actualize it. So subsequent actions of S provide the evolution of an assemblage to different forms, and this dynamical system can either be contingent, it can be random, or deterministic, and provides the rules of evolution of the assemblage, which may depend on local structures. So this is an example of evolution. Okay, can be anything. And of course, as you look at it on different scales, you have the persistence diagram, and this shows you what happens. So in all scales, you have a zero-dimensional structure. So as you move along scales, everything is simply connected. Then you have, again, one-dimensional hole that leaves in all scales, persists in all scales. And then if you look at what happens on two-dimensional voids, then you start with a one-dimensional void here, then there's another one-dimensional void here that comes up after filling this one and disabling this one, and then at the end of the day you have two such two-dimensional voids. So that can show in the persistent diagram in the second dimension, where you have this structure here that first emerges, then disappears, then emerges again, and then you have another structure that keeps on for larger scales. So this is an imaging tool, and it's also an imagining tool. So to close, we can have the concept of the imaginary abstract machine, and that comes under the name of random assembly resistance simulations. We have different abstract machines that can create different actualities. Then the singularities can foliate the possibility space depending on the choice of the dynamical system that acts on CN. That might depend on local rules influenced by local structure, and these rules may not be known or directly observable. However, whether a set of supposed local evolution rules is indeed compatible with the abstract machine under which the system actually evolves may be inferred by comparing the observed assemblages that are being actualized with the actualizations performed by the imaginary abstract machine. And this is something that we call simulation. And then there are complete statistical tools based on model selection that can be employed to select the particular imaginary abstract machine which is closer to the actual abstract machine, offering us an understanding of the actual rules that generate the assemblage. Okay. So these rules can be anything. This is one particular case of rules. So you start with a given set of vertices. Then for each possible pair of vertices, you create